Chester has the ability to vocalize sadness and pain in a way that I'm not sure I've heard any other vocalist be able to do it. It'd be tough for him to go out there and sing bubblegum rock. He just isn't that guy. He wants to believe and does believe in the music he writes. I met Chester in 1992. We were starting to form our first kind of garage band, and we had a guitar player who said he knew this kid who sounded just like Eddie Vedder. He was maybe 102 pounds, this scrawny little kid, wore glasses, had tight curly hair. He was not what I was looking for as far as what a rock star should have looked like. But then this kid just walks up to the microphone and he starts singing Alive from Pearl Jam, and he just was incredible. I was like, jaw on the floor, wow, okay. When can you start?
I've known Chester since I was 15 or 16 years old. He's a year younger than me. The first time I actually saw him perform was the Quad at lunchtime, and he was in a band with Sean. He was like, I guess not what you'd think of as a rock star, which is probably why I didn't pay as much attention as I should have when he was singing.
Once Grey Daze was formed in its entirety, we really started to see what could be and what was possible. And you can hear, just by listening back to that first record, the amazing talent that Chester had back then, not only for his vocal range and performance, but his ability to write melodies and the lyrics that we wrote together were really emotionally intense. Chester had that special ability to describe what other people were feeling and give them that immediate path to connect with him and the song. So this place, it's currently called the Rebel Lounge, but back the first incarnation of Grey Daze, this place was called the Mason Jar. And it was kind of like the starter club. Everyone from Guns N' Roses to Pearl Jam, Stone Temple Pilots, they would play this on their kickoff tours. It held like 250, maybe 300 people. So it was a regular spot for Grey Daze to play back in the day. Our very first show was at the Mason Jar in 1993. Chester was a minor, so he wasn't even 18 when we played our first gig, so he actually had to sit out in the back. We came in, we did sound check, then he had to go back outside until we played. He was allowed to come in and actually play on stage, and then had to go back outside after we were done. Yeah. But even his first performance was a great performance. He was just a great vocalist, and he always had so much passion when he sang. I think back to the times where we would be rehearsing and he would be, you know, jumping around the rehearsal room.
He's a natural frontman.
Yeah, he was one of those guys that was very into the history of the bands he liked too. He loved Stone Temple Pilots. So just the moves of what Scott Weiland would be doing on stage, he would study that. And then he would kind of integrate those moves into his own performance. When he called me and told me, you know, the guys from Stone Temple Pilots asked if I would sing for him, I said, well, so when do you start? And he just laughed. He goes, how did you know? I go, you can't say no to that. It's your favorite band of all time. I already know that you're going to say yes. This is a school for the arts now, but at the time, this was called the Electric Ballroom. This club, literally from the day it opened, was the new standard of what was awesome in Arizona. The sound system was insane. It was enormous. You sounded like gods when you were up on that stage. Mace was a guy that was playing at a national level. He was a world-class performer. He gave us that perspective and understanding of what we needed to do to become great live performers. Our stage presence became something that we could hold our own against any national band that come through town. So we're standing here at the site of where the last Grey Daze show actually was played. This place used to be called the Big Fish Pub. So this would have been late January, February 1998. We had just signed a demo deal with Warner Brothers. We were at the time drawing 1,800 people to our shows. Mace is a no-show for sound check. So now we're starting to wonder if something happened to him. About 15 minutes before we go on, Mace rolls up on his motorcycle, shirtless, with a gun on his hip and his bass on his back. And he pulls right up to us and whips into the parking spot and jumps off. And he had told us that he had had a falling out with his roommates and they had locked him out of his apartment, and he went and kicked the door down and he was upset and pissed off and didn't want to talk about it. And we start playing, we're 4 or 5 songs in and the band just sucks. And this was probably our worst show ever. And I can see out of the back of the room some commotion going on with the door guy. These two guys just bolt in and they jump on the stage and they punch Mace right in the face. He falls into the drum set. Show is just completely fucked. We just stopped. We apologized to the crowd. Chester apologized to the crowd.
I'm sober now and I get it.
Yeah.
And I can laugh at it. I can laugh at myself.
This is where it all ended, right here.
Me and Sean always talk about how much we admire Chester because we had convinced ourselves that we gave 100% trying to pursue our music careers, but we didn't give 100% like Chester did. Chester was willing to sleep in a car to go out to LA and play music. I think people were genuinely happy and excited that he made it. Everybody knew how much he sacrificed to get there.
The band broke up pretty hard, and there were a lot of hard feelings between myself, Chester, and Mace, and Bobby. And then in 2001, Bobby was diagnosed with brain cancer. He was our guitar player. Chester called me after not talking to me for a couple years and said, hey, it's been too long. We briefly flirted with putting Grey Daze back together. Eventually, Chester and I ended up becoming business partners in Club Tattoo in 2003. Club Tattoo is a luxury tattoo and piercing studio. We used to throw these anniversary parties. And he said, you know what I think would be cool is I think this is the year we bring Grey Daze back together. Why don't we start re-recording these songs? We'll put the album out probably January, February. We'll see what happens. He and I recorded a video explaining that we are putting Grey Daze back together for a reunion show.
What's up, everyone? This is Chester from Linkin Park, Club Tattoo, and of course, Grey Daze. And I'm happy to announce that on June 23rd at the Marquee Theater in Tempe, Arizona, Grey Daze will have our 20th anniversary reunion show.
He was gonna fly back to LA for a day, and then he was gonna fly to Phoenix. We're all gonna have dinner Saturday night, and then we're gonna start rehearsals on Sunday. Well, that was July 20th. July 20th happened. Chester tragically took his own life. Everything just stopped. I didn't decide to pick up the album again for probably 6 to 8 months after Chester passed. And I had to have a lot of conversations, work through a lot of politics, and work through a lot of people and people's emotions. And I had to start with Chester's widow, Talinda. We decided just to keep Kristen, Mace, myself as the core of Grey Daze and complete the record out at NRG in LA. And all of a sudden we start having record labels calling us saying, will you take a meeting with us? And we had some big dollars thrown at us. What was very concerning to me was to make sure that it was not a conversation about money more than it was a conversation about the legacy of our friend. It had to keep its integrity first and foremost. So we ended up signing a deal with Loma Vista Concord, and we worked together for the next year, and we really took our time. We used all of the original vocal recordings from the two albums we had done previously. So in 1993, we had recorded an album called Wake Me, and in 1997, we recorded an album called No Sun Today. And what we did was we took the original songs and we literally took all of the music off of those tracks and just kept Chester's vocals. It's raw, emotional, gritty, amazing vocal performances that I think his fans are going to be blown away by. And then we rewrote every song around the vocals from start to finish, everything. Drums, bass, programming, everything was new. I decided to talk to Mace and Kristen about maybe bringing in some guests that I think Chester would have liked to have performed with. And the first one that we were talking to out of the gate was Head from Korn. He and I had got along for years. We had tattooed him at Club Tattoo. So I sent him one of the tracks, and literally my phone rings. And I pick up the phone, he goes, what the fuck, dude? This is amazing. I'm fucking there. So then he calls me a day or two later and says, hey, I don't want to be too forward, but would it be cool if Monkey played on this track too? Marcos from POD plays on What's in the Eye. Head and Monkey play on B12. Jason Rauch from Breaking Benjamin and Head play on She Shines. Paige Hamilton from Helmet, he plays on a song called Sickness.
It's like a do-over. It's so bittersweet.
I know he was very proud of what he did with Linkin Park and what he had accomplished and what he had written. But I think Chester was always looking for initial creative outlets, whether it was playing with other bands or whether it was painting, or whether it was writing piano by himself in his bedroom. You could not take him to a party without him picking up a guitar in a corner and playing it.
You're the judge, oh no, oh, set me free, oh no. You're the judge, oh no, oh, set me free, oh no. I know my soul's freezing, now that for good reason. So please, take me. Thank you.